Hello friends, in the previous session we have started our discussion on the compounded motors, and I told you the basic idea behind a cumulatively compound motor and a differentially compound motor. Now with the let us continue the tradition. Always we have given an introduction, and the next topic is usually the terminal characteristics. So in this particular session, let us start with the terminal characteristics of a cumulatively compound DC motor. Now, I already told you terminal characteristic is the plot between the output parameters, right? So this will be a plot between the torque versus omega. Any terminal characteristic in any subject is usually the plot of the output parameters, all right? So in this case, motors, we are having torque and omega. So I have already written down the equation. The net MMF will be equal to the magnetic MMF produced by the shunt field winding plus or minus the series, depending upon whether it's a cumulative and or a differential. And of course, armature reaction is always going to reduce the flux. I forgot to write the equation for this. That is the IF star. Remember, the reduced, in this case, it can be a reduced value of IF or an increased value of IF. All right. So depending upon whether it's a cumulatively or differentially compound. So IF star, which is corresponding to the new current for the new flux, will be equal to this equation will be the IF, the original value of IF, plus or minus, all right, this will be N series into IA, right, N series into IA. So here I would get the value to be N series divided by NF, all right, into IA, because the series winding has the armature current flowing through it, and minus the F armature divided by NF. Right, this equation we have already derived, so nothing we have done. This net MMF is nothing but the value of the field winding multiplied by IF, right? So we are dividing throughout by NF in both sides of the equation. All right, so with this, let us start with the terminal characteristics. So you know that there are two fluxes in the compound motor. All right, two fluxes. One is due to the shunt winding, and the other is due to the series winding. You are getting both the best of two worlds, series and shunt. Now, shunt winding, you can see, it is a constant value because the voltage applied is constant, constant DC voltage, ISH would constant, and therefore the shunt winding flux would be a constant value. Okay? But the series winding flux, actually it would vary with respect to armature current. If you load more, more IA would flow, and you would get a higher value of the series flux. All right, so this is a load dependent flux. So that is the first thing which you have to get into our board. All right, now let us see what are the difference we get in a cumulatively compound motor with respect to shunt and series motors. All right, so let us take the first parameter, which is the starting torque. The starting torque is actually the instant at which you start the motor, what is the torque. Now take my word for this. During the starting, the motor would draw a huge amount of current. All right, the speed is zero, still the motor would draw a huge amount of current. Actually, it is because the back EMF is not present there. And you know that IA is equal to VT minus EA by RA. Right, and EA is nothing but K phi omega. So at starting position, at omega equal to 0, EA equal to 0, so IA would be equal to VT divided by RA. Now you have seen all the problems, RA is around say 0.06 ohms or something like, very small value. And if VT is 220 volts divided by 0.06, this is a very large value. And therefore the inrush current, the initial current inrush would be very high. Of course, you use DC motor starters to prevent that current to go into the motor, otherwise the motor would be fried. It would just burn instantaneously. So use DC motor starters. That is a topic for a different discussion actually. So just remember that at starting, the IA value is very, very high. IA value is very, very high. Now for a shunt motor, you know that for a shunt motor, torque in general is K phi into IA. All right. And this phi is the function of phi sh, which is a function of IF, and IF is a constant value, and usually it's a very small value as compared to the armature current initially. All right, because this is usually say 40 ohms or something like that. 220 by 40 is much less as compared to IA during starting, right? Now, for a series motor, the torque is always proportional to K into C into IA square. That also we have derived, because the function flux in a series motor is proportional to the armature current. Therefore, I into IA would give you IA square. Right? So, in a cumulatively compound motor, the flux is equal to, the fluxes would add up, right? The net MMF actually adds up. All right? So, for a cumulatively compound motor, the starting torque would be higher than the shunt motor. Okay, because you are having two parameters here, right? So for the cumulatively compound motor, torque is equal to K into phi plus phi SE into IA. Right? So the shunt motor effect is there and the series motor effect is there. Therefore, the starting torque will be very high. So the starting torque is high as compared to shunt motor. So for, let me just take the next page here. So for cumulatively compound motor, torque at starting is greater than torque at starting for a shunt motor. Alright. But as compared to a series motor, the series motor is KC into IA square, and IA square is a very high value. Whereas in this case, it is only 5 plus 5 SE. Right? So, during starting, for cumulatively compound motor, torque starting would be less than as compared to a series motor. So, this is for a torque at starting for a series motor. So, this is the first conclusion. The starting torque would be higher than the shunt motor, but less than the series motor. Alright? So, one good thing about the cumulatively compound motor is that you know that at very low loads, the motor would overspeed in case of a series motor, because it does not have any magnetic flux produced by the shunt winding, whereas the shunt winding has a smooth profile. So the advantage is that it does not run away at light loads, because there is always a value of flux present. The flux is not zero in the initial value. Because if flux was zero in the initial value, the speed would go very high. Okay? But in cumulatively compound motors, you always have a shunt winding, okay, which is already there. And therefore, it will have a shunt characteristic there. Therefore, it does not run away at light loads. So to draw the CARA, that is the torque induced terminal characteristic and omega. So you need a reference here. So this is the shunt motor characteristic. You all know that. And this is the series motor characteristic. This also you know. This is the series motor characteristic. Therefore, the cumulatively compound motor would come somewhere in between these two characteristics. Okay? But how does it behave in light loads and higher loads? So light load in this area and higher loads in this area. Now, like a series motor, it does not run away. Okay? So under light loads. Okay, the motor behaves like a shunt motor. Alright, please take down all these things. Of course, I will be providing a summary. And at our high loads, it behaves like a series motor. Okay, so now don't confuse light load with starting condition. Starting condition, the armature current will be very high. Light loads, we are telling, after the motor has the rated current, it is drawing a little bit less current. You are reducing the load. Light loads. And high loads means the motor is comparatively drawing higher current. Alright? So, under light loads, it would behave like a series shunt motor. And under heavy loads, it would behave like a series motor. So this is under light load and this is under heavy load. Okay. So here it behaves like a series motor and here it behaves like a shunt motor. Why does it behave like a shunt motor here? Because under light conditions, when IA is less, the flux series is less, and the only thing is the flux due to the shunt motor. But here, the IA is considerably higher, that the effect of the shunt field winding is overcome by the series winding. Okay, so here it behaves like the series motor. Alright. So if you want another graph, I can draw another graph here just showing the shunt motor and the cumulatively compound motor. For example, this is the omega and this is the torque induced. Okay, so your shunt motor would have a characteristic something like this, okay, from starting to stalling condition. So the cumulatively compound motor would initially behave like this, right? This is a straight line. And then after, once armature current has reached a considerable value, it would follow the series motor path, and this is the starting torque. So clearly, starting is greater than the starting for the shunt motor. So in this graph, it's clear that the starting torque of a series motor is much larger than the cumulatively compound. The starting torque of the cumulatively compound motor is much higher than the starting torque of a shunt motor. Let me see if I have made that mistake here. You know, yeah. So this is for the cumulatively compound motor. Cumulatively compound motor. So I hope that you have understood the terminal characteristics of a cumulatively compound DC motor in this particular session. In the next session, we will start with differentially compound motor. All right. So if you have liked this video, please like, share and subscribe my channel for more videos like this. And I'll see you in the next video. Thank you.